In the 1930s, there was a popular newspaper game that had people guess the prettiest face out of 100 photographs. Readers would look at 100 photos and then choose the 6 that they thought were the prettiest. The newspapers would count all the submissions, and if your choices included the most popular choice, then you were entered to win a prize. In economics, this game is known as the Keynesian Beauty Contest. This is because John Maynard Keynes first wrote about this game in 1936, and he used it as an analogy for how financial markets work. More importantly, he used it to show how human behavior and reasoning shapes individual decision-making. The game illustrates how human beings operate on different levels of thinking. Let's take a look at how it works. Let's start with the base level. The simplest approach to the beauty contest is to choose the faces that you personally find prettiest. Economists call this a naive strategy. Now, one level deeper. If you assume that everyone else will pick the faces they personally find prettiest, then you should pick the faces that you think everyone else will find prettiest. This is a slightly more sophisticated strategy, but what if everyone else is thinking the exact same thing? Then we have to think yet another level deeper. We have to think about which faces everyone else thinks everyone else will find prettiest. This logic escalates quickly, and it's a very slippery slope. At each level of thinking, the player assumes that they are one level deeper than everyone else. Keynes thought that this was how the stock market worked. Investors act like participants in the beauty contest, using different levels of reasoning to decide which stocks will bring a profit. Everyone's trying to sell before everyone else sells and buy before everyone else buys. But this process of reasoning exists everywhere, not just in the stock market. Take this scene from The Princess Bride, for example. Wesley, or the Dread Pirate Roberts, has poisoned one glass with iocane powder, and Vizzini has to figure out which glass is safe to drink from.
All right. Where is the poison?
But to do so, he has to be thinking about how Wesley thinks.
All I have to do is divine from what I know of you. Are you the sort of man who would put the poison into his own goblet or his enemies? Now, a clever man would put the poison into his own goblet because he would know that only a great fool would reach for what he was given. I'm not a great fool, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you must have known I was not a great fool. You would have counted on it, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
Let's take a look at the modern-day beauty contest game, the two-thirds the average game. In this game, everyone is told to choose a number between 0 and 100, and the winner is the person closest to two-thirds times the average of all chosen numbers. So if there are three players and their guesses are 20, 30, and 40, then the average guess would be 30. Two-thirds times the average is 20, so the winning guess is 20. Just like the old newspaper game, the strategy for this game is to think about what other people are thinking. So, how does this game play out? A base level or zero level thinker might pick their favorite number or a random number. And if lots of people are randomly guessing numbers between 0 and 100, then the average is likely to be around 50. A first level thinker reasons that most people aren't going to think much, so they'll pick a random number, and that will mean an average guess of 50. So, a first level thinker should guess 2/3 times 50. Or 33. A second level thinker will go deeper. If most people are first level thinkers, then they'll guess 33. So I should choose 2/3 times 33. I'll guess 22. A third level thinker will go deeper still. If most people are second level thinkers, then they'll guess 22. So I should choose 2/3 times 22, which is 15. And on and on and on. Eventually, this logic will drive guesses to zero. If everyone were to think at the deepest level, then everyone would guess zero. And if everyone chooses zero, then the game reaches what's called a Nash equilibrium, a point where everyone has chosen their best strategy and where no one could benefit from changing their guess. If humans were perfectly rational, then we would all guess zero because we would have thought through every level. But this isn't what happens in reality. When researchers run this experiment, the results look something like this. This is a simple distribution of guesses, and it tells us a few things. The winning guess is usually somewhere between 10 and 20. In this case, it's 13. Notice that there are a few spikes in the data. The first is around 33. These are our first-level thinkers. The second spike is around 22. These are our second-level thinkers. And the last spike is right around 0 or 1. These are infinite-level thinkers who have figured out the rational solution, the Nash equilibrium. So what does this tell us? It illustrates that everyone operates on different levels of thinking. This can happen for many reasons. It could be how much time we have, how much information we seek, or even how much training in economics we have. This graph also reminds us that humans do not have perfect rationality. We don't always have the capacity to think through every possible scenario. We have what's called bounded rationality. Sure, a few people thought through to the rational solution, but that's only about 10% of all the guesses. In the two-thirds of the average game, theory tells us that the solution is 0, but the winning number was 13. Sure, 0 may have been a better guess than randomly selecting 78, but it's still pretty far from 13. A big lesson here is that there are serious flaws in armchair reasoning. We can sit there and apply all the economic theory in the world and still lose the game. One way that we can combat this is to run our own experiments. In one study done by Rosemary Nagel, researchers sent out this two-thirds of the average game to newspaper readers. They asked participants to comment about how they chose their number. And they were surprised to find that many people actually ran their own experiments with friends to pick a number. In general, researchers found that people who ran their own experiments were on average closer to the winning number than theorists or the public. This tells us that it's often much more valuable for us to run experiments than it is to reason from the armchair. The Keynesian Beauty Contest perfectly illustrates the gap between how we predict people to behave and how they actually behave. It reminds us that formal logic is pretty useless in the real world. And it tells us that theory is just that, a set of statements or ideas used to explain how the world works. But theory is built upon assumptions, and if those assumptions start to crumble, so too will the theory. We should be thinking more about the reasoning process people use to make decisions. Too often we assume that our logic is rational, but that's just not the case, and we'd be much better off blending theory with our learnings from experimenting. That's the value in playing the beauty contest game. The experience can help us understand how people think, and how our beliefs about what others think can shape markets. But most importantly, it can help us make better predictions and appreciate the important role that behavior plays in decision-making.